Thank you so much, and welcome to our Minnesota Institute for Astrophysics lecture, co-sponsored by the Bell Museum. I can't really see you very well, but a show of hands if you have been to the Bell Museum or know about what's going on at the Bell Museum. Are you excited about the new Bell Museum? We're very excited. Thank you for being here. My name is Leah Peterson, and I'm the Adult Programs Coordinator here at the Bell. And it's been my pleasure to work with many of the faculty and researchers with MIFA for the last few years to do this lecture and also to do some other really cool programming around town. I wanted to give you a quick Bell update because it's really nice now that our space is closed to have events here and see people in this space, even though it's not exactly the museum. We still have offices upstairs. We're going to be up there probably until next winter. And the new museum, which is at the corner of Larpenteur and Cleveland on the St. Paul campus, is almost totally finished looking from the outside. They still have a lot of details to attend to. It's going to be open on, hopefully July 1st, 2018, but certainly summer 2018. But if you do cruise by there, you'll get a really good sense of what it's going to be like and what that space is. And we really encourage you to check it out. We have some great graphics also out in the lobby that you might have noticed. Anyway, I just want to plug one other quick program that we share often with the faculty of MIFA and a lot of other research faculty around the university and indeed from other institutions. It's called Café Scientifique. Has anybody here ever heard of Café Scientifique? Sweet. Maybe a couple. That's a program of mine, actually, and it's over at the Bryant Lake Bowl. Our next one is coming up on April 18th. It's a Tuesday night. It's $5, and we bring world-class research to the Bryant Lake Bowl, to an intimate, small theater space, and it's sort of a cabaret-style event. So you can have a beer, you can have your dinner. Our next research, and we've had many of the researchers from the Minnesota Institute for Astrophysics there over the last few years talking about amazing things. This next one on April 18th, happens to be a biologist. His name is Jeff Lang, and he studies the gharial crocodile in India, in the Ganges River. They're the fish-eating crocodile that have these really crazy long, like, needle-nose plier snouts. And if you're interested in hearing more about those, come join us, I guess it's like next week already, at the Bryant Lake Bowl on April 18th. All right, without further ado, I want to hand it over to the director of MIFA, Minnesota Institute for Astrophysics, Evan Skillman.
Thank you very much, Lee. Well, I'm just thrilled to see all of you here tonight. You've made my day. Anytime I see that this lecture is working, that we're getting large attendance, I'm extremely happy. It's my job tonight to introduce Lindsay. It's a special week in astronomy. The Hubble Space Telescope proposal deadline is this Friday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern time. And so if you see astronomers wandering around campus sort of not knowing what they're doing, it's too much caffeine and all the great ideas are just pouring out. So we're all a little distracted. But otherwise, this is the great week because we get to have our MIFA public talk this evening. So, and also the twins have a winning record, which doesn't happen very often. So all of those things make this a great week. And so Lindsay is our newest faculty member to the Minnesota Institute for Astrophysics. As you'll see, she works on our sun, the nearest of all of our stars. She's our favorite faculty member because she's our latest addition. she comes from Minnesota. Esko, Minnesota, is those of you who know where that is in northern Minnesota. Lindsay has some family here. So she went to San Francisco State as undergraduate, then she moved all the way to University of California, Berkeley, to do her master's degree. She stayed there to do her PhD. She stayed there to do her postdoctoral research position. Then she stayed there to do her research position, and then she came here to take the faculty position in Minnesota, which we're extremely happy about. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Lindsay for this evening's talk.
Okay, and now I know why I was asked to give the public talk today, because solar physicists do not use the Hubble telescope, so I don't need to be writing a proposal right now. Okay, as you can see, the title of this talk is Exploring the Mysteries of the Sun, and specifically looking at explosions that are happening on our nearest star. But I want to start out by saying that this is not by any means a new thing. You're thinking that we're going to look at the sun make some measurements, figure everything out. This is something that we as a human race have been doing literally for several thousands of years. So just as one example, this is the Chanquillo Observatory in what is now modern Peru. But this observatory is very, very old. It's over 2,000 years old. And this is most likely was at one point a religious site, but it was also used for measuring the sun and specifically for keeping track of dates. So you can see here in the picture on the left, 13 towers, the 13 towers of Chanquillo. And people puzzled over a long time about what these were, and it was eventually realized that this was a very clever calendar system. So by keeping track of where the sun rises over these towers, if you stand at an observing platform over here and you see, okay, well, it's between the second and the third tower, or it's just over the middle of the third, then you can keep very good track of what time of year it is, you know, probably down to a couple days or so. So it's a pretty clever way to track the sun. And what's even more clever is that they put an observing platform not only on this side but also on the other one. So that means that you can use the sunset as well as the sunrise to check the date. You've got more than one opportunity. Now, if we go a little bit, or actually much farther north to what is modern Mexico, the ancient Mayan civilizations were also doing a lot of tracking the sun. And they were tracking the sun as well as all of the other major astronomical objects to such a high degree of precision that they developed models that could actually predict when solar eclipses were going to happen. So that took some pretty sophisticated math in order to be able to predict that, but they kept very detailed records and were able to make predictions. So this is really not something new that we just came up with a little while ago. The human race has always been very interested in understanding the sun. Now, as far as exploring the mysteries of explosions on the sun, that, on the other hand, it turns out we've only been doing for about 160 years. So our knowledge on that is fairly young. In terms of trying to understand explosions, or what I'll define later as solar flares, what we typically do is start out by looking at sunspots. Sometimes they can be a little hard to look at. Okay, there we are. We have some sunspots. So this is what a group of sunspots looks like as seen by the Solar Dynamics Observatory. This is NASA's flagship mission for looking at the sun. And specifically, this instrument is called the Helioseismic Imager. It tends to spend most of its time looking at things like waves that are bouncing around within the solar surface. What we're seeing here is a group of sunspots. Sunspots are regions of very high magnetic field. They're hot. They tend to appear as dark when we see things when we see them in visible light. Visible light means the white light sort of wavelengths that we can see with our eyes. So this is what it might look like if you could look through a really high-resolution telescope at the sun. Now, unfortunately, to look through this particular telescope, you would need to get up to orbit and take a look at a spacecraft. So having these very high-resolution images of sunspots can be pretty useful for trying to understand solar flares, but we're fairly fortunate to have this avenue open to us nowadays. It hasn't always been that way. In fact, in 1859, the sort of observations of sunspots looked nothing like this. They looked a lot more like this. So this is a drawing. This is pen on paper. And it would really take you a lot of time to record your family vacation if you had to use it, do that using this particular technique. But that's what was available at the time. So in 1859, this is how observations of sunspots were made, and this particular observation was made by a scientist named Richard Carrington. Richard Carrington had a telescope set up, pointed at the sun, and had it set up so that the image was projected on a piece of paper. Now, he put appropriate filters in front of the telescope so that he didn't burn a hole in that paper. But using a setup like that, he was then able to essentially just trace out by hand what was it that he saw on the paper, and that turned out to be a very good way of record keeping of what sunspots looked like, how many there were on a particular day, and so a lot of records were made in that particular way. Now, on one day in 1859, Carrington was sitting there sketching out sunspots just like he did most days, and he stepped away from his work for a little while to attend to some other business. And when he came back, he saw something very unusual. It was this, these two little spots right here. Now, I told you earlier that sunspots usually look fairly dark to us in visible light, but he saw bright things instead. And what was even more curious is that these bright spots weren't there before. So this was a very sudden change that had happened on the sun. Now, that doesn't really sound like that big a deal, like, okay, it's the sun, it does a lot of stuff. It changed, big deal. But this was a very big deal, because at that time it wasn't thought that things like that could happen. The sun was thought of as this largely static or perhaps slowly varying object in the sky that showered us with light, showers us with warmth, and gives us what we need to survive. The thought that there could be some sort of sudden change was a little bit disturbing. And this is the first recorded example that we have of that. Now, because this was a little bit surprising, and scientists being scientists, when Carrington told people about that, they didn't believe him. They said, well, you just drew that. I mean, come on, you were just drawing on paper. You can draw whatever you want. But he said, no, I really saw this. I promise that I did. Now, fortunately for Carrington, he wasn't the only person. So another person also saw this as well. That was a scientist by the name of Hodgson. And he made an independent measurement of the same phenomenon on the same day at the same time. And his drawing, his observation, looked very similar to Carrington. Now, armed with that, two independent verifications of a single phenomenon, the two scientists were able to convince the community that what they had seen had, in fact, taken place. Okay, so that was the first observation that we know of a very sudden event on the sun. And this was a solar flare, or a very intense burst of light that happened suddenly. It turns out that it was also associated with something called a solar eruption, and I'll tell you more about that in a bit. And that means, the solar eruption means, that this wasn't the only unusual thing to happen on this day. So shortly after Carrington noticed that there were some sudden changes on the sun, the telegraphs started going crazy. There was an intense amount of interference. And so that was a little bit unusual. And then a few days later, it happened again. The telegraphs went crazy. The level of interference in the telegraph signals was so high that the telegraph operators essentially just unplugged their equipment and allowed the telegraphs to run solely on the power of the signals that they were receiving from this intense geomagnetic storm. You know, that's really a lot of power. That wasn't the only thing that happened. I'll skip through a few. There were some intense northern lights on that particular day in 1859. Now, northern lights, or the aurora borealis, are something that I think many people in Minnesota are pretty familiar with, at least the people from up north. So the Esco Corner over there is fairly familiar with the northern lights. But it's a little bit more unusual to see things like this in Cuba. And there were northern lights in Cuba on this particular day. The aurora borealis was seen all over North America. So this was a very, very intense event. This was a big geomagnetic storm. And in fact, it's one of the biggest that we know about, perhaps the biggest that has happened in recent centuries. Okay, so this was another unusual occurrence on that particular day. And Carrington had the idea that perhaps these things were related. The sudden change he saw in the sun with the sunspots might be related to the telegraphs, it might be related to the northern lights. But scientists being scientists, nobody really believed him. I mean, how can a change on an object that's 90 million miles away possibly affect my telegraph system that I have in my basement? Okay, so people didn't believe him so much at the time, but with more observations over time and better models of what might be going on, it was gradually understood that these things were related, that what we call a geomagnetic storm here on Earth was somehow related to the solar flare and the solar eruption that Carrington saw. Now, nowadays, this is what the observations of sunspots look like. And I've put this picture in here so that you can actually see what it looks like during a flare. So once again, you've got these dark sunspots here, and then you've got these intense bright parts that, although this is not a movie, happen quite suddenly. So this is sort of the modern version of what it was that Carrington saw. And even today, it's actually a little bit challenging to see what we call white light flares like this. The sun itself is pretty darn bright. And so if you want to see some increase on top of that, you have a fairly large background signal that you're trying to work against. Okay, so with more observations, we began to understand a little bit more what these events were and what was causing them. And we now refer to these events as solar flares and also coronal mass eruptions. So events like this can start out with a flare, a bright flash of radiation on the sun. These can spit out a solar eruption. This is a huge amount of plasma that gets spit out into interplanetary space on the order of several billion tons of plasma. So it's not a small amount of material. Now, if that amount of plasma happens to be directed our way, then it slams into the Earth's magnetic field. Now, we are pretty fortunate to have that magnetic field and also the Earth's atmosphere protecting us, but some of that energy can get in. So some of the energy enters the magnetic field. Particles are accelerated, and we tend to see effects like strong magnetic electric occurrences on Earth, the sort of thing that could potentially affect our power grids, just like it affected the telegraphs back in 1859, and very intense aurora that you can kind of see showing up here. So these solar storms make up some parts of what we now commonly refer to as space weather. So just like there's a weather report in your newspaper or on TV every day, you can also look up a space weather report to find out if it is predicted that the Earth is going to get hit with a solar storm anytime soon. So this leads to a lot of interesting questions. I mean, it's obviously well worth our while to try to understand how these events occur. It's also worth our while from an astrophysical perspective. I mean, here we have a huge amount of energy being released. We have several billion tons of plasma being spit out into interplanetary space. We want to know how that happens. And those same processes could be at work on other stars, in other astronomical objects. And here's a relatively nearby laboratory that we can use to study those. So let's try to get to the bottom of this. And we're going to ask questions like, how do solar flares and eruptions happen? And not just how do they happen, but what triggers them? How do all of these particles get accelerated? How does that mass of plasma escape the sun? And perhaps when can we tell when they're coming? And do we know if they're headed our way? In order to try and understand how these arise, I think it's a good idea to take a look at the sun's magnetic field. This is what it doesn't look like. This is the Earth's magnetic field. And the Earth's magnetic field, at least to first order, is something we can model as fairly uniform, relatively simple, at least to first order. And this is because a large part of the sun is rotating as a rigid object, and it gives rise to a relatively simple field. It's not like that for the sun. The sun is more like this. So we start out with a rotating sun. Now keep in mind that this isn't a planet that has a solid surface or a solid core. This is essentially a seething ball of plasma, really hot gas. And so it doesn't have to all rotate at the same rate. It turns out that the equator, the middle of the sun, rotates more quickly than the poles do. And that takes what would have otherwise been a fairly simple magnetic field, and it wraps it up into something more complicated like this. As that keeps rotating, the magnetic field gets more and more complex, more and more wrapped up, and that's where the interesting things can happen. Here's a little bit of a zoom in on some of that. So we start out with the rotation of the sun, and then if we took a peek inside the sun, due to the equator moving more quickly than the poles do, we would find that there are a lot of flows happening just beneath the surface. So these are essentially like currents in the sea of plasma that exists below the surface of the sun. Those currents can occasionally bubble up magnetic fields to the surface, and we see those fields like this. We see it what essentially looks like bubbles on the surface of the sun. And sometimes these bubbles can get so complicated that we start to see sunspots, these regions of very high dense magnetic field forming. So here's a little animation that shows that in a bit more detail. So here we've got the sun rotating. The magnetic field starts to get twisted up. It gets more and more complex. The flows under the surface start. And before we know it, we have a very, very complicated magnetic field that looks sort of like a ball of yarn after a cat has gotten to it. Now notice in this complex field, sometimes you end up with field that is very close to other lines, up here, maybe up here. This is perhaps happening here. And every time a field, let's say, gets close to itself, there's the opportunity for it to reconfigure into a lower energy state. So in all of those places where the field is essentially getting tangled up, where the lines cross each other, the field can reconfigure and be a little bit simpler. Every time it sees an opportunity to do that, it takes that opportunity, and that's when we get a solar flare. These are three images of solar flares happening. All of these images are from NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory, and all of these images are in what we call extreme ultraviolet light. So this is like ultraviolet, but even more so, it's extreme. And these three flares in progress are pretty bright. There's a lot of energy being transferred here. This one is so bright that it's actually saturating the camera. And just so we can get a sense of the scale, you know, here's the Earth drawn in to scale. And here's the size of the event. This event up here, this flare is associated with a coronal mass ejection. That is one of these eruptions that's throwing off a huge amount of plasma into interplanetary space. So these events are pretty bright. There's a lot of energy that gets transferred. Okay, the sorts of questions we might ask in order to try to understand these better are, how does that energy get transferred? I mean, we're really talking about, for a big solar flare, the amount of energy that's equivalent to about 1 trillion thermonuclear bombs. And all of that energy gets transferred in a matter of minutes to hours. So it happens very quickly. So how do you transfer all of that energy? What triggers it? You know, what do you really need to build up in order to be able to have the lines cross, reconnect, and release energy? And why is it that some of these flares are associated with big eruptions while other flares just happen and essentially don't spit out any plasma away from the sun? So these are some of the questions that we'd like to try to answer in order to understand the sources of space weather a bit better. But I'm going to throw on one more question into the mix, and that's why is the corona of the sun so hot? Now, it sounds a little bit silly to ask a question like, why is the sun hot? It's the sun. I mean, it's hot. It's just, that's the way it works. But the question here is really not, why is the sun hot? We know the answer to that. We know that there is energy coming from nuclear reactions in the core. But the question here is, why is the outside of the sun hotter than the surface of the sun? That's not really what we would expect. To tell you what I mean by that, let me show you a sort of cross-section of the sun. Now, I'm going to skip over some of the layers in the interior here. I talked a little bit about the flows that were happening in this layer, but I'm going to jump right up here to the photosphere, which is what we usually refer to as the surface of the sun. It's a little bit wrong to call it the surface, per se, because I'll remind you that the sun doesn't have a solid crust like the Earth does. It's really just a seething ball of hot plasma. But we call this the surface because it's the part of the sun that we can see. So this is where the light that we can see with our eyes comes from. So that's what it looks like the sun ends. But the sun doesn't end there. As we go up from the photosphere, we pass a relatively thin layer called the chromosphere. And after that, we get into a layer of the solar atmosphere that we call the corona. And this is essentially everything else. This is everything outside those few layers of the sun, and it extends far out into interplanetary space. Now, the corona, as you can sort of tell just from this diagram and this image, is relatively not dense. So this is a place where there is not a lot of plasma. There aren't a lot of particles. It's about 10 billion times less dense than the air here on Earth near the surface. So there's not a lot of material there. And that means it can be relatively difficult to see. I mentioned that with our eyes, we can see the photosphere, the surface of the sun, very well. That part tends to be quite bright. And that means that trying to make out this very faint, very tenuous corona in the presence of the bright surface of the sun is difficult. Here's one way to do it. You can take the moon and put it in just the right spot. These are images of the sun that are taken during a solar eclipse, and these images are in different wavelengths, so they're marked with different colors. And if you can do this, if you can take the photographs at just the right time when the moon is blocking out the sun, then you can get rid of all of this emission from the surface of the sun, and you can see the corona itself. And you can see that in a lot of beautiful magnetic complexity. Here you can kind of make out some of those very complex strands that I was talking about earlier that get tangled up and could potentially reconnect and release energy. Okay, so the corona is obviously pretty beautiful and also very complex, but there are more mysteries than that. The corona is also very hot. It turns out that the surface of the sun is just under 6,000 degrees. That already sounds pretty hot. But the corona is at 2 to 3 million degrees, so it's much, much hotter. And this is not what you would expect off the bat. I mean, if you were to build a fire at home, if you had your hands up close to it, you'd expect that it would be hot. And then as you moved your hands farther away, you would relatively expect that things get cooler. That's not what happens here. If you put your hands up to the photosphere, you're at only 6,000 degrees, and then as you move your hands away, it shoots up to 3 million. This isn't what you would expect, and you need a huge source of energy in order to kind of maintain that temperature differential between those. So what could provide enough energy to do that? Well, I did tell you earlier that solar flares can release a huge amount of energy from the magnetic fields, so maybe that's a way you could do it. You could have enough flares happening all over the sun, then it can essentially take away from the magnetic field bit by bit and put that energy into heating up all the plasma instead. So that's one possibility, but it's not the only one. Another possibility is that you could potentially have waves that are emanating up from the solar surface. This would be a way to get all of that energy from those undercurrents that are happening below the surface up to the corona, and then maybe you can dissipate the energy there. Or maybe there's something else at work that we just have no idea about at the moment. All right, so we've got to answer these questions somehow. And how are we going to do that? Well, the best technique is to try to look at as many different wavelengths of light as we can. And that's because when you look at light in different wavelengths, in different colors, each of those wavelengths reveals something a little bit different about the sun because it's sensitive to different things. Just like some objects are red and green, so you could see different things when you look at those objects in different colors. The sun has a lot of different phenomena that reveal themselves at different wavelengths. All of these images here are from NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory. This one down here is the white light image. So this is something sort of approximating what you might see with your eyes, if your eyes were that good. And then going up from here, this is ultraviolet, and this is the extreme ultraviolet range here. Now, each of these wavelengths have been very finely tuned in order to pick out a particular temperature on the sun. Each of those colors is sensitive to a different temperature. And so when we look at the sun in these different wavelengths, we tend to see different phenomena. Some of those are pretty sensitive to this complex magnetic structure up here in the corona. So that looks like some of those extreme ultraviolet wavelengths will be useful for studying the corona and potentially looking at solar flares. But if we want to understand the highest energy phenomena that are happening on the sun, then it's probably a good idea to use the highest energy light that we possibly can. And by highest energy light, I mean the most extreme light on the electromagnetic spectrum, and that's X-rays and gamma rays. Now, how might you get X-rays from the sun? One way you can do that is to have energetic electrons, charged particles, moving through some sort of ambient plasma. They'll hit a whole lot of protons. This is sort of like bumper cars. And every time the electrons run into protons, you can release a little bit of energy and have that energy exit the interaction in the form of an X-ray. And so it turns out that this process is very efficient on the sun for producing X-ray energy that we can measure. When we measure the X-rays from the sun using spacecraft, this is kind of what we tend to see. So these are maybe the solar surface parts down here. These are related to the sunspots that Richard Carrington saw, although they're not exactly them. And what we tend to see in X-rays are two things. One is we see the locations where accelerated electron beams, very high energy beams of electrons, charged particles, run into the surface of the sun and deposit energy. And the other thing we tend to see are very hot loops heated up to 4 million degrees, or even during flares, even 10 million, 20 million, 50 million degrees. So even much, much hotter than the corona is usually. So this is what a sort of typical observation of the sun, at least of a flare, looks like in X-rays. Now, how is it that we get an observation like that? You're probably aware of the fact that it's not so easy to look at X-rays. I mean, that is not something that we can just do with our eyes. You need something special to do it. And it turns out that traditional telescopes don't work very well for that. it's pretty hard to reflect X-rays. They tend to just either go right through material or else they get absorbed. And that's why X-ray images work so well for medical purposes. But if you want to reflect and focus them, that turns out to be difficult. And so traditionally what we do is to use a very indirect way of trying to measure X-rays from astronomical objects. This example shows the RESI spacecraft. This is a NASA spacecraft. And the spacecraft rotates so that the X-rays coming from the sun are forced to go through two sets of grids, and then we measure them afterwards. And as the spacecraft rotates, we can kind of look at, okay, at which time do the photons make it through? At which times are they blocked? And by doing some, quite honestly, really not that interesting math, we can try to work out where are the photons coming from? How many sources are there? What is the shape to the source? How intense are they? And we can try to work out what are the X-ray images from flares like. And doing that, we're able to produce this image that I showed you earlier, that X-ray image is from the RESI spacecraft. Okay, now in this image, I noted that we can see high-energy beams of electrons hitting the solar surface, and we can see superheated plasma. But there's a lot in this image that we're missing. You know, I mentioned earlier that the place where we think the energy is released from the magnetic fields is way up here in the corona. And so there ought to be some pretty interesting things going on there. But it's the same problem that I mentioned earlier. The corona just doesn't have that much density to it. There aren't that many particles up there for the energetic electron beams to run into. And so that means that the emission up here in the corona, where we think the interesting stuff is happening, tends to be very, very faint. So if we're going to measure that and try to get a better idea for what's happening nearer to the site where energy release happens, then we're going to need better instruments than this. We need to build instruments that have better sensitivity so that you can see fainter things. And we also need to build instruments that have better imaging so that you can make out what's happening over here from something very faint that's happening right next to it. And what's more, it turns out that we need to do this in space. So we can't make X-ray measurements or gamma ray measurements from the ground. X-rays and gamma rays don't make it to the ground. That is undoubtedly a very good thing for our state of health. Pretty happy about that atmosphere. But if you want to make X-ray images of the sun, that really turns out to be a big downer. It means that you're going to need to get a telescope all the way up into space. This image here shows you the penetration power of light across the magnetic spectrum, all the way from radio and microwave up to gamma rays, and how far it gets through the atmosphere. Here's us down here, or maybe up on top of a mountaintop. And you can see that the radio wavelengths make it all the way through. The visible light, the light that we can see with our eyes, that obviously gets through because we can see the sun with our eyes. But there are some bands here that don't make it, including X-rays and gamma rays. Gamma rays get down a little bit further. So if you can get an instrument high enough up into the atmosphere, maybe you've got a chance. But for X-rays, you really have to get to space. Okay, so the next question I'm going to ask is, how is it that you get to space? That's not the easiest thing to do. First, let me tell you how it doesn't happen. This is not how you get to space. You don't just get together with your friends, have a lot of discussion, come up with an awesome telescope that you want to build. Then you just buy a kit, put it together, and you've got a spacecraft. And then you just put that up there. How hard could it be? Now, it doesn't work that way. You cannot buy your spacecraft at IKEA. Instead, in this middle region here, there tends to be a phase that we call testing and development. And the name of the game here is, how do you know that your telescope is going to work? I mean, if NASA's going to put $100 million down on a spacecraft, then they really want to know that technology that you're putting on that spacecraft will work. So you're going to have to prove that. And you're going to have to prove it in space. You're going to prove that this instrument can make the observations you say it will. And you also need to prove that it can withstand the pressure, the thermal environment, the vibration that it's going to take to get there. Okay, so then the question becomes, how can we test something, at least in space? And there are a few different options for doing that. One of those options is to use what's called a sounding rocket. Here's an example of one launching, and I'm going to talk a lot more in detail about a particular project that lies in that category. Another way you can do this is to use a high-altitude balloon. especially, let's say, if you wanted to look at those gamma rays. You know, I mentioned that you don't have to get all the way to space. You just have to get pretty high up in the atmosphere. So you could potentially do that on a NASA high-altitude balloon like that. Another way you can do it is to build what's called a CubeSat. These are becoming quite popular nowadays, and these are very small. You know, here's the hands for scale, but really these spacecraft are about the size of a shoebox or even smaller. And these are relatively inexpensive in the grand scheme of things because you can essentially take this as what we call a piggyback on board another mission. So if somebody, if your best buddy has a rocket that's already going to space, then you can be like, hey, can I get a ride? Well, if your spacecraft is that big, then they'll probably say yes. And in fact, although I won't have time to cover that in the scope of this talk, the University of Minnesota is working on a CubeSat project right now. So we are hoping to be able to test some technology using spacecraft on that size. Okay, so I want to return for a moment to the concept of sounding rockets. You know, I mentioned this earlier. I'd now like to tell you what that is. A sounding rocket is a relatively small rocket that launches a payload almost straight up. So you launch almost straight up, and then the motors that give you the liftoff from the Earth will gradually fall off. At that point, the payload is what we call ballistic. So it's just going to go up as far as it's going to go, and then it's going to come back down, and you can figure out exactly how long it's going to stay there based on the kinematic equations. Okay, so all in all, this technique will get you into space, but you're not going to get to stay there very long. Your payload, your experiment, your telescope is just going to come right back down. If you're lucky, the parachute will come out. And so that means overall, from this sort of technique, you can expect to get on the order of 5 to 10 minutes of observation, not hours, minutes. And so next, I'm going to tell you the story of one particular instrument that rode on a sounding rocket, and we'll do so again. And this instrument is called FOXI. FOXI stands for the Focusing Optics X-ray Solar Imager. Now, there's a lot in that name, but you can kind of pick out the important parts just from that. Solar imager means it makes images of the sun. X-rays means it's doing that at very high energy. And focusing means that it's not using the technique that I told you about earlier. This is the one I mentioned earlier, where you had to play this game with two grids, and you kind of said, okay, the photons made it through. Now they didn't, now they did, now they didn't. And you tried to work out what that meant about where the source was on the sun. Well, wouldn't it be a lot easier if you could just build a reflecting mirror and focus the X-rays? And so that's what we're trying to do here. It's not so easy to get X-rays to reflect, but you can do it if you have them hit your mirror at a really small angle. So here the X-rays come in this way. They reflect twice off these mirrors, and then they focus at a distance several feet away. Building a set of mirrors like this, you can take multiple mirrors and nest them together and get complete revolutions. That'll give you an instrument that looks something like this. And with this, you're now able to do direct reflecting focusing. Okay, so that's what FOXI is trying to do. The goal is really to use a focusing telescope to investigate the sun at high energies and see if we can determine a little bit more about how the energy is being released from the field and potentially what heats the sun. Now, we've done this twice so far. The first time was in 2012, and then we did it again in 2014. A very nice thing about flying a sounding rocket is because if that parachute did open, then that means that you get your telescope back. So you can open it up, you can look at its state of health, and you can potentially take it and fly it again and put it on another rocket. This is a little bit of a glimpse of what is inside the experiment, you know, what is the telescope itself. On this end of the telescope, you have reflecting optics. These were produced at a NASA facility called NASA Marshall in Huntsville, Alabama. Here are different mirrors that we'll take and nest together to produce one module like this. And then we have 7 of those inside our telescope. Now, it doesn't do so much to just reflect the X-rays. You also need some way to collect them. And so on the other end of the telescope, 2 meters away, we have 7 X-ray detectors. These are essentially X-ray cameras, just like is in your phone, except they can see X-rays. And these are made up of strip detectors. So there are strips that are going across here. The strips are made out of silicon for some of these X-ray cameras and cadmium telluride for others. And these detectors, these X-ray cameras, are provided by the Japanese Space Agency. Okay, so this is the instrument that was built for the purposes of directly focusing X-rays from the sun. The next thing we have to do is actually get it to space. So to do that, we go out to the White Sands Missile Range, which is in New Mexico, about an hour north of El Paso. So this is really out in the desert. The White Sands Missile Range is a region about 3,000 square miles wide, fairly near Las Cruces, New Mexico. And White Sands has really been very integral in the launching of NASA sounding rockets, essentially since the start of NASA. So launches have been going on there for many decades. I'd now like to give you a little bit of a flavor for what it's like going to a launch facility, putting together a telescope, and actually launching it and putting it into space. The first thing you have to do is put everything together. There were not IKEA instructions for this. So this shows a team of scientists and engineers working on the electronics for the X-ray detectors, testing everything as they go to put things together. After you've done that, you need to integrate or put together your telescope with the rest of the rocket, the rest of the payload, and that takes many more people. So you can see there's a large number of scientists and engineers who end up having their hands in this at one time or another. This right here is the shutter door that needs to open for us to be able to see the sun, see the X-rays coming from the sun. It also needs to shut afterwards if we want to be able to recover that thing in one piece. After you've done this part, after you've put everything together, it's now time to test it and make sure that it really can do what it needs to survive the trip. This is a very rough ride for a telescope. And so you have to test many things. I'm actually going to stop this video right here because this always impresses me. This entire telescope, the experiment, the payload, weighs about 1,000 pounds. And it turns out that you can pick that up with just a single strap, as long as you put that strap exactly on the center of gravity. It always makes me a little bit nervous when they did this. I mean, what if that thing tips just a little bit? But it never does. This works quite well. The next thing we need to do is measure as many properties of the payload as we can. This includes spinning it to see how stable it is. So we try to spin it around as many axes as we can. We put it on a vibration table and we shake it to make sure that it can withstand the high vibration loads at launch. And then finally, after we've done all of that, this is what it looks like when the payload is built up and put together on the launch rail. So that entire experiment, the payload that we saw earlier, is up here, hidden in this styrofoam box. Here are the two motors that will actually get this thing off the ground. And then up here are the support systems, and in the nose cone is the parachute that we're going to use on the way back down. Okay, so let's take a look at what happened when we launched this in 2012. It goes pretty fast, so here's a slow-mo. It takes about a minute and a half for it to get up to the altitude where we need in order to start our observations. And so it's a pretty cool video. It was very exciting to see this in person, but that's actually the least exciting video that I'm going to show you. The next one is another view of the launch, but this is from a different point of view. This one you just saw is the point of view of somebody on the ground looking at the launch, but we also have a camera on board. So we actually put a GoPro camera on our telescope that was pointing down, looking at the ground. And so for the next video, I'll ask anybody who's prone to motion sickness to please close your eyes. Okay, there's the liftoff. Here's where we start spinning, and we're going to go faster. We're going to go a lot faster. The first rocket motor has now finished firing and is falling off. The second motor is firing now. You can start to see the horizon in the edges of the field of view over here. This is actually a combustion instability that occurred in the motor. It turned out to be at frequencies that we can see and hear with the GoPro camera. Those mountain ranges down there are starting to look pretty, pretty small. This is really fast. I really hope it stops spinning soon. There we go. Okay, so now we stop spinning because we need to not be spinning in order to make our observations. And we stop spinning essentially by throwing some masses out to the side to get rid of angular momentum. And here you can see the telescope starting to acquire the sun. Okay, but that was just getting up there. The whole reason for getting up there is that we wanted to measure X-rays from the sun. So next I'm going to show you some of the data that we measured during the first flight. And what you're going to see, first of all, is that things were looking pretty quiet. We weren't seeing a whole lot of mission until we did. We had a sudden surprise about halfway through the first flight, the first observation of Foxy, and that's that a solar flare occurred over here. Now, I talked a lot about solar flares earlier, and I said how important it is for us to understand them and how there could be a lot of them happening quite frequently. But still, you don't expect to just see one right when you looked at the sun. I mean, it took Carrington until 1859 until he was able to capture one with all his sunspot drawing. So it's not the sort of thing that just happens in any five-minute observation, but one happened during our flight. And that turned out to be a very fortunate occurrence for the project, because that meant that we had a relatively well-understood source that we could use to try to demonstrate how well our telescope worked. And the number one way to do that is to compare it to other telescopes. And so here I have some images from the previous standard instrument for looking at the sun, which was RESI. Now, the solar flare is over here. Everything else you see in this image is essentially imaging noise that's coming from this indirect method of imaging. The FOXY image, on the other hand, looks much more simple and free of noise. So this is how much better you can do when you do direct focusing rather than relying on this indirect technique. And this is what it looks like if you zoom in on that small solar flare to see it up close. Now, we did have another flight, and for the second flight, we made a lot of changes to improve the sensitivity of the telescope. So with more sensitivity, there's a lot more to see. And here, we're not only seeing solar flares, there were two more that happened during this flight, we're also seeing regions where there are a high number of sunspots and regions that are very hot on the sun. So we're still processing this data to see everything that we can learn from it. Okay, so that's about 6.5 minutes in space. But I mentioned earlier that everything that goes up does have to come down. So let's take a look at that part. Here we are on the camera again, and now we're going to see the landing of the payload. What's happening now is that the payload re-enters the atmosphere. The parachute comes out, and now we are essentially swinging on the bottom of the parachute. We're going to keep on descending. There's the shadow, and then it'll hit the ground. It always lands on the camera. I don't know why. And there's a scientist who has come to retrieve her telescope. And fortunately, the landing went quite well both times that we did this, so we were able to recover the experiment with very little damage, so we can fly it again. And so I think that would be a good idea. Let's do that. And in fact, we have plans to fly this experiment at least one more time. The University of Minnesota is the lead on this project, and we are planning to fly again in about mid-August of 2018. And here you can see a meeting that happened last year that brought a lot of the FOXY team members from Japan, from Berkeley, from two different NASA centers to Minnesota for our kickoff meeting. Now, that's not the only thing we have plans to do. I mentioned earlier that one of the things you want to use sounding rockets for are to test things out so that you can eventually put things aboard a bigger spacecraft instead. And our experiment has worked pretty well so far, so we plan to do that too. And so we have proposed this technology to NASA for use on a small explorer, which is a spacecraft. And with a small explorer, with a satellite that can observe for a lot longer than 6.5 minutes, we think we'll really be able to make a lot of progress in understanding how energy is transferred in solar flares. Now, this will be a much larger, much longer instrument. Here you have the optics over here and the X-ray detectors back here, and then they'll be separated by a 14-meter telescoping boom that gives you a very long focal length. So this is much more than you could fit on a rocket. Okay, so those are some pretty exciting things on the horizon. But I did want to point out that so far we're looking at the corona from a pretty far distance. You know, these are new ways to make high-sensitivity X-ray images of the sun, but we're still making images. We're staying over here, and the sun is 90 million miles away, and we're just taking pictures of it. You know, is there another way to do it? Is there a more direct way that we could try to investigate some of these issues of energy transfer and how the corona gets so hot? And in fact, why don't we just go there? The Solar Probe is a project to go there. Solar Probe is a NASA mission to fly a spacecraft into the outer region of the corona. And the scientific goals are to trace how energy and heat move through the solar corona and to explore what accelerates the solar wind. This is a large amount of plasma that comes out relatively continuously from the sun. So we exist within the solar wind that permeates throughout the solar system. And Solar Probe will also explore what accelerates the particles that are spit out from the sun during flares and other events. Here's an animation that shows what the orbital trajectory will look like. It turns out if you want to get close to the sun, that's not a very easy thing to do. We tend to think that if you can just escape Earth orbit, then maybe you'll just fall in, right? It turns out that it's very hard to go to the sun. Planets that are in orbit around the sun are going very fast, and so if you want to get closer to the sun, you have to shed a lot of energy in order to do that, or you have to get to a different trajectory entirely. And so Solar Probe uses a trajectory that makes use of 7 Venus gravity assists. So it goes around Venus and uses that to change the direction of its trajectory in order to take it into an orbit that will get it closer to the sun. So you can see that the closest approach here is way inside the orbit of Mercury. And the orbit of Mercury is essentially as close as we've gotten before. The Helios spacecraft went about that far, and there have been spacecraft that have been in orbit around Mercury itself. This is much closer than that. It'll be 3.8 million miles from the sun. That sounds like a lot, but you can see on here it's a lot closer than we are now. And to really get to that closest approach, this point here, you know, at that point we'll be about 7 times closer than previous spacecraft have been. It takes about 7 years with 7 of those Venus gravity assists in order to do that. And once the spacecraft is at its closest approach, it'll be going at a velocity of about 120 miles per second, not per hour. It will actually be the fastest object that's ever been made by humankind. The launch is expected for July 2018. So it really sounds like the summer of 2018 will be exciting. We're launching Foxy again. Solar Probe will launch. The Bell Museum is going to open on the St. Paul campus. So yeah, there's really a lot to look forward to that summer. The mission itself includes 4 different sets of instruments. One of them in particular, called the Fields Instrument, is a set that will make direct electric and magnetic field measurements, in particular looking at the waves that pervade the space around the spacecraft, really the set of waves that exist in the outer corona itself. There will also be other instruments to measure the accelerated electrons and ions, both the ones that are coming out from flares and also the ones that are present in the solar wind, as well as an imager to take images of the corona. Now, I particularly wanted to highlight the Fields experiment because the University of Minnesota is playing a major role. And here you can see Keith Getz and John Wygant, although there are several other scientists and engineers here at the university who have put a lot of work into this set of instruments. And this is a major role for Minnesota, not only in terms of providing actual hardware components, but also in performing the science itself. Here you can see the power supply that was built to be very low noise. Here's that same power supply inside a thermal vacuum chamber that you put it in to test it in a very low pressure environment where you can make it really hot, make it really cold, and see if the instrument can survive. The time domain sampler is a part that has had a major component from Minnesota, and this is based largely on previous instruments that Minnesota built for other spacecraft, but there are also some pretty new things being done here. Along with other instruments on Solar Probe, the Minnesota team will actually be measuring accelerated particles and waves at the same time and correlating those on board. So you can try to figure out, are they happening together? Are they related? What's causing the waves? What's accelerating the particles? And what exactly is the distinctive relationship between the two? Okay, so once the mission gets very close to the sun, as you can imagine, this is going to be a fairly tough thermal environment for the mission. And so what the mission has is a heat shield that's located right here. This is a carbon composite shield that is located there particularly for the purposes of shielding the instruments from the really intense radiation flux from the sun. It'll be over 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit on one side, the solar-facing side of the heat shield. And on the other side of the heat shield, the majority of the instruments are going to be sitting at roughly the same temperature that we are right now. So that's a pretty incredible engineering feat right there. There are also two sets of solar panels on the spacecraft, one that you use, that, let's say, when we're about as far from the sun as we are now. And then as we get closer and closer and closer, the solar panels will fold up, and a second smaller array will be used instead. That small array of solar panels will be liquid cooled so that it doesn't overheat with the intense flux on it. Okay, so I think that's about all I have time for to talk about those particular missions. I want to leave you with just one closing thought, which is that if you're thinking about a road trip, late August of this year, not next year, this year, would be an excellent time to do that. And the reason for that is that there's going to be a pretty unique event. There's a solar eclipse that's happening on August 21st of this year. Now, an eclipse happened, as I mentioned earlier, eclipses happen when the moon gets in the way of the sun, between the sun and the earth, and casts a shadow on the earth. The thing that's so unusual about this eclipse for us is that this is the first time in many decades where the total eclipse will be seen from North America. Now, this line here shows you where the path of totality is. So if you're somewhere on this red stripe here, you'll actually see the moon completely block out the sun, and then you'll be able to see the corona in all its beautiful glory yourself. If you can't quite manage to make it to this line, if you're a bit off that instead, then you'll still see an eclipse. It's just not going to be a total one. So you'll see the moon kind of cutting a chunk out of the sun, but it won't quite go all the way across. So I suppose from here, if you want to get to the path of totality, Nebraska is your best bet. Being a solar physicist who likes to look at the corona, I plan to be over here in Portland, near Portland. Okay, so I think with that, I will probably wrap up. I hope I've given you an idea of some of the interesting questions that we're wrestling with in trying to understand the astrophysics of the sun, and also an idea of what are some of the new techniques and missions that we're using in order to try to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lindsay. We have time for some questions. When the questions are over, there's also some students outside that have set up some telescopes, so you'll be able to view that. But first, let's get some questions here, okay?
If you're in the area where there's a total eclipse, can you look at it with your naked eye without hurting your vision? Will the corona hurt your eye?
That's a good question. The corona itself is so faint that the corona is not going to hurt your eye, but the thing that I would worry about is what is happening in the moment before totality and the moments after totality. So you will want to get yourself some sun-safe viewing glasses in order to look at the eclipse. Thank you for bringing that up.
The energy that comes out of the sun can damage our satellites. Does anyone know how often, once every 10 years, once every 50 years, it would be enough to do a lot of damage to the satellites?
Good question. It is true that radiation from the sun associated with solar flares and solar eruptions has managed to take out instruments on spacecraft. There's a very high radiation dose that is experienced not only by spacecraft instruments, but also, you know, potentially by astronauts if they were in the wrong place at the wrong time. As far as how frequently the major events happen, it's a probabilistic sort of thing. So it's a bit like saying when an earthquake will happen. But one can try to say when it's more probable than other times. The sun goes through 11 years cycles in its activity, and at the peak of each of those cycles is the time when we expect to see a lot of very big events, but we still don't know when is going to happen in 1 hour or 2 hours. Right now, we're kind of on the declining phase of one of those solar cycles, so we wouldn't really expect to see a huge event now, but there has been at least a little bit of evidence that points towards large events showing up relatively late in cycles, so it is possible. There have been large flares and events happening on the sun recently, so maybe keep an eye out to see if there are any aurora.
So is the Solar Plus probe going to actually enter the corona itself, or just like kind of stay outside of it?
Depends what you call the corona. I would say yes. John, what do you think? Would you call that entering the corona? Yeah.
Could you repeat that just in case anybody didn't hear in the back?
Sure, yeah. I deferred to John Wygant on that, who spent a lot of time working on solar probe. What he pointed out is that we don't really put an edge on the corona. There's not some sharp cutoff to it. So you can, if you want to, and plenty of people do, think of the corona as essentially permeating throughout the entire interplanetary space. So we're in it right now, depending on how you want to define it. Let's just say it's getting to a more interesting part of the corona than we're in.
Sorry, I just wanted to know, do you use Maxwell's equations when we were showing those magnetic fields, of calculating sun's magnetic fields, or is there some more complicated theory used?
You definitely need to use Maxwell's equations in order to get those fields. And using those equations has a lot of consequences for what exactly can happen when those field lines cross, as I said. You actually can't have field cross. So whenever it's about to, you have to have something give. And that's where we get this switch to a lower energy state. And so it's sort of Maxwell's equations that are keeping us honest there.
Hi, you mentioned the 11-year cycles. And I was just kind of curious about the magnetic fields. Do they kind of go back into a low ebb in a low period where they have released a lot of energy or something like that, and then the high energy times is when they're reconnecting?
That's one way to think of it. Really, the magnetic fields that we see, you could characterize in terms of complexity. So how complex is it? If it's very complex, that is more likely to give us a flare or an eruption. So that is one way you can think of it. During the very active times are when the field is more complex, at least in the corona. Now, as for what's going on underneath the surface of the sun, it's quite active in the sense that there are high magnetic fields, there are currents going underneath the surface, even at solar minimum. So it's not, so to speak, that the sun kind of turns off for a little bit.
Have the coronas before destroyed any onboard electronics of the interplanetary spacecraft like New Horizons or the Voyagers or something like that? Or have they had any effect on the Kuiper Belt or the Oort cloud?
Okay, so the question was, has the sun essentially taken out some spacecraft before? The sun has caused irreparable damage to instruments in orbit around the Earth. I don't know offhand if it has, let's say, taken out interplanetary probes. But when you stop hearing from your interplanetary probe, you don't always know what happens. One thing that can happen is that sensitive electronics, especially computers that are aboard spacecraft, are very sensitive to radiation from the sun passing through and causing upsets within the electronics, within the computers. And when that happens, your spacecraft might just kind of stop talking to you.
I had a question about the diagram for Carringer, Carignan. Mm-hmm. It had an N and S at the top and then a P and an F, where you'd expect east and west. What do the P and F stand for?
Yeah, I don't know, and I was wondering the same thing. If you find out, please send me an email.
If you enjoyed this talk, which I'm sure you did,
And you'd like us to notify you of future talks like this, please fill out these yellow cards and hand them back into Annie at the back of the room. Annie's collecting all these things, and we'll do our best to keep you informed as to when all our future talks are. We'll have two more talks next year also. If you go out that door and out to that side, you'll encounter some students with some telescopes, and so you can do some naked eye viewing and some telescopic viewing. I'd like to thank Lindsay once more for a fantastic talk.